we're going to focus on the fun part, which is transportation inbound, merchandise in transit, part 18. Let's see. All right. So what's the deal with that? So basically, this comes into the mind of the entry part of the exam. When the merchandise arrives from the United States, perhaps let me do this. Let's do this, folks. All right. So here is the world map, right? So how? So sometimes United States is here, right? Things can come from the north, Canada, from the south, Mexico, from Latin America by plane or by sea, from Europe or Asia by ship, also by plane. And whenever they arrive, they sometimes have to the routing structure, the way it works, is the clearance process may not be in the place of final destination. I am not sure if this is still done to this day, but a lot of Federal Express shipments, air shipments, shipped from East Asia, comes to Alaska, and then from Alaska it comes to the rest of the country. So if I have a shipment from China to Florida, it is likely to go to the hub in Anchorage, Alaska, and then from Anchorage, Alaska, it would fly down to Florida. Why they do that, I do not know. There is cost reasons, there is other reasons. Of course, Alaska is part of the United States. And so when it comes from China to Alaska, but the final destination is Miami, Florida, there is a decision to be made by the importer or by the carrier. And the decision is, where do I clear customs? Do I clear customs in Anchorage? Or do I clear customs in Florida? If I clear customs in Anchorage, then I go through the normal entry procedures with customs in Alaska, and that's the end of the game. Pay duties, etc., etc. But this is not the only option. What another option is for me to come into the Alaska, put it on a different plane, bring it to Florida, and clear customs in Florida. This does not have to be Alaska only. It can be any other place. So if we increase our lovely map of the US away, it can be Los Angeles. It can arrive by the ship to Los Angeles, then go on a railroad and go all the way across to the New York state and clear customs in New York. That's another possibility. So the transportation inbound, the part 18. So we're talking about part 18. Title 19. Code of Federal Regulations. Focuses and deals with the rules that guide this type of procedure where if you bring it in one port of the United States and then you deliver it to another port of the United States and you clear customs in there, they provide rules for all these parts in between. What happens in between before you clear customs? You enter the country, you enter the United States, but those you have not started your regular entry process, like entry for consumption or entry for warehouse. So, in other words, the name of it is merchandise in transit. Transit to where? Transit to the port or final destination, where it will finally go through the customs formalities. Sometimes it can be also called as transportation inbound. Right? So what are these rules? Well, before we dive into the rules, we have to talk about definitions. So we start off with the same page, and those definitions include the common carrier. Common carrier. Well, common carrier is a fancy word for the mode of transportation to transport things. Can be done by railroad, by the ship, by the pipeline, or by the truck. Of course, rules may vary if it is for vessel or for the truck and the railroad, for example, because sometimes vessel may need to take a different route in order to arrive to a place of final destination. So let's say the shipment arrives to Portland, Oregon, and its final destination is Portland, Maine, right? So Portland. How is it going to get from Oregon to Maine? Well, it can be trucked over, it can be railed over, it can also be shipped over. If it's going to be shipped over, or the normal transportation route would be to put it on a ship, go all the way here, hit Panama, there is a Panama Canal, go through Panama Canal, and then either from here or here, go all the way to Maine and unload to Maine, right? Pure geography. Of course, to go from here to over here, it may take longer. So the rules for this transportation, for this delivery route, is 30 days. For here, if it's by ship, it can take 60 days. Once the merchandise comes in, so it comes into the port. So this is a port. It's day one. How many days can it stay on the dock? Calendar days, right? If it stays beyond, it goes to the general order, right? How many days can it stay in the airport if it comes to the airport? 15 calendar days. So what's the point here? The entry must be made within 15 calendar days. What kind of entry? Transportation inbound entry. Or IT entry, for example, immediate transportation entry. In other words, entry is an application to transport the good in the United States while it is in a customs custody. It's very important. In bond, what does it mean, in bond? In bond or in transit, it means all this time the merchandise didn't clear customs, duties were not paid, the merchandise didn't enter the customs territory in the United States, it is still in customs custody. All right. But even for that entry, it must be, there is a 15-day calendar rule, which is applicable. All right, so within this time frame, within this 15 calendar days, you have to do what? Once you make an entry, and how do you make an entry? What do you do? Pretty much this is what you do, you fill out this form. CBP form 7512. And you fill it out. And once you do that, you have made an entry. And after you fill out this form and submit it to customs, another time period begins ticking, the 5-day rule. And the 5-day rule stays within 5 working days. No, this calendar days. Now you have a 5-day rule, which can start from anywhere over here. So it can start from day 1, it can start from day 15, but it must be 5 days, 5 working days. Five working days, and that means that within 5 working days of a presentation of an entry, that little form that we mentioned, oops, that one, within that form, you, a carrier, so like a truck driver or the railroad company or the ship if it's going around through Panama Canal, they must take a receipt of merchandise. Of course, if no other entry is filed, such as consumption entry. So that means that there is a timeline when this must be done. If the carrier doesn't do that, then the entry is canceled and merchandise will be treated as unclaimed. So here is another timeline for you to keep in mind. The 30-day rule I already mentioned. So the final port of destination, the time between final port and the originating port must be 30 days. So if the merchandise is received in Los Angeles and its final destination is New York, it must get to New York in 30 days. It's important date because customs examiners test you on this. And they pretty much test your knowledge directly on those days. They say, which one of the following correctly fills in the blank, blank? And the blank is about merchandise transported overland, such as LA, New York route, Los Angeles, New York. Immediate transportation, it's one of the type of entries which are covered by transportation in bond. And if it's covered by the in bond entry, how many days? No later than blank days after the date of receipt of the forwarding carrier to the port of origin. Well, the receipt must be taken within 5 working days after the entry, after the transportation entry. So now, what do we have? We have 30. That's it. 5 days is for the carrier receipt, 30 days for that carrier to get to the port of final destination. 60-day rule for the boat. So if you put it on a boat, you have more time, and the reasons for that are plentiful, such as the one I described for the one going to the port of Canada. Irregular delivery. So also has a definition, because irregular in one's mind may mean totally something different in another's. And in this situation, it talks about if the delivery fails to deliver it within 30-day rule or within 60-day rule, if it goes by water, then that delivery is irregular.